So I'm Greg Smith. I work for Second Quadrant, which is a global Husker consulting company. I run the division of the company that's in the United States. One of the things that first got me involved in working with PostgreSQL full time was doing performance tuning for things that just did not execute as fast as they needed to for the workload. And so how I managed to get into a full time job, which is pretty cool. One of the things that I have noticed about Postgres is that there's enough differences between how Postgres fits together and what we need to do to use it successfully than a lot of commercial databases that it seems like there's some common problems that I won't say everyone, but a lot of places do the same things. So if you look at 10 Postgres sites, you'll discover half of them probably run into a couple of problems that I'll talk about here. Some of it is just reorienting yourself to how open source tends to work as opposed to how commercial software tends to work. Some of it is just there are things in Postgres that are not as slick as we'd like them to be, and if you get big enough, eventually you run into these problems. And some of it is just corporations and corporate IS and that whole sort of thing. People who tend to work with databases are pretty regimented and process-oriented compared with some other groups in the software industry. And some of those processes, if they've been developed against other databases, there's a little bit of a disconnect as far as how you translate them over into Postgres that cause some friction. So part of the idea here is to talk about what those problems are and to try to get you to where you're at least thinking about them even if you're not running into them yet, because especially in a bigger company, you can end up taking months to get some of those things sorted out. Just because of the paperwork involved. So, speaking of paperwork, there actually is an enormous amount of information available for free for not all that expensive about Postgres. There's a manual, there's a big FAQ. It's not just like a throwaway FAQ. There's really good stuff in there. There's a couple of books on the market. I have two of them. I wrote one of them. There's a wiki, an official PostgreSQL wiki, which I'll include a couple of links to. There's all kinds of good articles on the wiki. Part of the problem is, you might say, well, why don't people read the manual? The manual is, last time I checked, over 2,400 pages long. So the problem is not so much, is it in the manual or not? In a lot of cases, the stuff that I'll talk about is in the manual. The problem is, how do you find it? I mean, it's really hard to find enough time to go, hey, let me sit down for a little bit and let's read the Postgres manual. You know, it's hard to find that month of time you can go through it. A lot of the information is pretty dense, too. So no one actually gets to read the whole manual. You read the sections of it that are interesting to you, but there's a little bit of a dependency issue here, which is how do you know which sections are the interesting ones if you haven't already read it first? So part of what I want to do here is talk about these are the things you should go looking for in the manual. In some cases, the descriptions in the manual are very good. You just have to know this is the magic word you want to search for because that's what this is called in Postgres, and this is what you want to do. Version policy is one of the things that is in that disconnected bit with corporate IS. Postgres numbers its versions with what's called a major and a minor version number. So if you're going to go from 8.3 to 8.4, and you're going to go from 9.0 to 9.1 or something like that, this is actually a major version upgrade. When you do a major version upgrade, that requires all the things that you would expect from a major version upgrade. You can have applications break. You're going to have to go through a possibly not easy QA cycle to find the problems. There can be major problems you run into. So, going from 8.3 to 8.4, expect problems. The really problematic one is 8.2 and earlier 8.3, which I'll talk about in a minute. If you just get what Postgres calls a minor version, right, you go from 8.4.3 to 8.4.4 or something like that, Postgres has some very specific guidelines for these things. The first is, unless you absolutely have to change something because it's necessary to fix a bug, don't touch it, is one of the first rules. So there's never intentionally any feature changes here unless they happen to be that the thing was broken and we have to fix the bug and we want to get it to work. So some other databases, people have run into problems where they upgrade to a newer version of the database and someone decided to add some optimization to speed up something and it broke queries and now the application doesn't run anymore. And so after such incidents, IS departments tend to do policies like no version upgrades to the production database ever, because we got burned by that once. The idea here is that the kind of problems that get into these minor version updates, they tend to be pretty serious. There can be significant problems that involve database corruption fixed in these updates. There was just one recently revolving around the PG upgrade tool. It's actually a very serious fix. You really not be smart to avoid getting the newer version of 9.0 that has that fix for it. You don't intend to use that thing. Also, some of the bugs that you can run into are really bad. The last really bad one that I had a lot of customers impacted by is there was a long-standing bug in relation to how auto vacuum worked, where it could end up getting into a state where it was no longer what it was supposed to. These are the kind of problems that get fixed in minor version updates. They're not, let's go play around with this code because we feel like messing around with it, the stable version. Stable version is taken very serious in the Postgres community. The sort of line for these changes, and they're called backports because these changes will start in a newer version of Postgres typically. Like right now, if someone makes a change, it's going to start in 9.1 normally, because 9.1 is the version of active development, and then it gets backported to 9.0, 8.4, 8.3, however far back it makes sense for that thing to go in the supported version. The idea behind a backport is if it's not really clear whether this makes sense to change or not, the spirit, at least, of that guideline is it more risky to have this change or to not have this change? So, for example, if this is a data corruption problem, there's always a possibility, well, I'm going to go touch code. Touching code always has the potential of breaking something, but if you know for sure you are absolutely going to get data corruption in this particular code path under these conditions, and you fix it, you've added a little bit of uncertainty. Hey, wait a minute, there's some risk. I've introduced new code into the database. It could have bugs in it. Well, but the code it was replacing definitely had bugs in it. So the concept should be not applying these small version updates, these minor version updates, is considered the risky thing to do. The risky thing is not getting the updates and never doing updates. You know, the risky thing is not, hey, I'm probably gonna break my application if I do this. What you may have to do, especially if you're in a very strong IS process kind of environment, is you might not want to call these version updates because people get scared sometimes of that term. So what other database vendors tend to call these, you may want to adopt that terminology and start calling it, well, this is a Postgres fix pack for bugs, or you know, it's a service pack or a hot fix or something like that. And if you look at the release notes for a new Postgres version, you can almost certainly find something in there that sounds scary and that you might run into and say, hey, I need to go apply the Postgres hot fix for this problem where if we ever decide to use PG upgrade, you know, these things will end up happening. That sounds like the sort of thing that people go, okay, well that, okay, yeah, we need to do that, that makes sense. Where if you tell them, we need to do a version upgrade to fix this problem, people are like, no, I don't want to do a version upgrade. So you may have to tweak the terminology a little bit, and to refer to these as something like a service pack is completely appropriate. That's more what they're aimed to be rather than big updates. So what we recommend is that if you're running Postgres, you stay on the most current minor version of whatever you've got. So if you've got 8.4, you want to be running 8.4 dot whatever the latest 8.4 is at any particular time. You can just avoid a lot of problems that way. And also, if you post problems to the mailing list that are known to be issues with the version that you've got, people will be slightly less sympathetic to your calls if you haven't done at least the minor version of your 8. People in the community understand you may not be able to do a major version upgrade for some reasons, but there's no downtime other than you have to restart the database, which takes a few seconds involved to get a minor version updated. Nothing really changes, just load the new binary in, stop the old binary, start the new one. About the only thing that's troublesome about it is if you want to roll back to the earlier version because you are the rare person that runs into one of these problems, that actually is harder to do than I think everyone would like it to be. So you may have to deal with that by getting a little intrusive as far as how the packages for Postgres are using it. Starting version. Postgres 8.3 is where I really got interested in Postgres because it fixed a lot of major architectural issues in the performance of the database that made it much more practical to deploy on bigger systems. So the performance of just about everything is significantly better. There's also part of the reason for that performance gain is there were a lot of internal changes under the hood that shifted around things that you can't really adjust easily later. So there is a tool available initially in Postgres 8.4. It's gotten much more serious than Postgres 9.1.9.1 called PG Upgrade. What PG Upgrade does is it lets you make a copy of the database and upgrade it to a newer version without having to dump and reload the entire new data. So it takes upgrading to a newer version of Postgres from something that could take hours or days on a big database to something that should only take minutes. You still need the test, you still need to do QA, everything else, but the actual mechanics of the upgrade itself are pretty quick using PG Upgrade. The trick is, because there are all these major internal changes from Postgres 8.2 to 8.3, you can't use PG Upgrade on earlier versions of 8.3. So the Postgres development team is trying very hard that you can upgrade using PG Upgrade from 8.3 to any later version, possibly with intermediate steps at some point. But you're never going to be able to dump an 8.2 or 8.1 database and do it directly. You're going to have to do a dump and reload. So there's a third thing to be concerned about, which is that one of the more external changes that got made in Postgres 8.3 is related to data type casting. Casting is things like, I've got something that's a text field, but it's a number. I want to change that to be a real number instead of text that just happens to hold a number. It was possible in earlier versions of Postgres to be pretty sloppy with that stuff, and the server would make a guess about it and go off in its merry way. A lot of that behavior got clamped down and doesn't happen anymore. So if you develop an application on something earlier than 8.3 and you move it to 8.3 or later, it's probably going to break. It's one of the most disruptive upgrades that's happened. It's certainly the most disruptive upgrade in the last 5 years of Postgres. The thing to realize then is if you start on 8.3, you're not going to run into this casting problem when you try to upgrade later. You're going to get better performance from day one, and you're also going to be able to use in-place upgrade. So the way I try to explain to people is every day that goes by that you're running a Postgres 8.2 or earlier database and your database is getting bigger, you're making the scope of the upgrade problem coming one day bigger too. You'll always be able to get them. The question is whether you'll get them for free from the Postgres community or whether you're gonna actually have to pay somebody to do the work of doing it. So if you're starting a new project and you're not starting like weeks to 8-3, you're basically saying I want a taste of this terrible problem. One of the reasons people tend to start with an earlier version is that's the version that comes with their operating system. Up until recently, for example, a lot of environments run PostgreSQL 8.1 because PostgreSQL 8.1 is what comes with Red Hat 5. The things derived from Red Hat 5. Part of the theory on that is, well, I won't be able to get support if I use a newer version of Postgres. Or, well, the versions that come with Red Hat go through more QA, and those are probably better than whatever ones I can get from the Postgres site. So all these things are wrong. In fact, the person who's worrying about the Postgres packages for Red Hat is also a member of the Postgres core development team. It's the same set of people doing all this work is what you really should realize. The people who are doing the packaging, whether you get the package officially from Red Hat or whether you get it from the Postgres Yum repository or something like that, they're not identical in all cases, but it's all the same people, the same QA process that they're going through. There certainly are advantages to getting Red Hat support and having that stuff available, but you shouldn't say, this kind of goes back to the theory I was mentioning backwards before. If you start on something earlier than 8.3, you're guaranteed to run into a bunch of these problems. If you say, well, I won't be supported if I use an earlier version, you're saying, well, I'm going to pick a problem that I might run into and prioritize that over a problem I definitely don't run into. So it's really not a great trade-off to make. Luckily, this situation has gotten better recently. I believe Red Hat 5.5, maybe it was 5.4, one of the relatively recent versions has now added PostgreSQL 8.4 as one of the official options. So instead of installing the regular PostgreSQL package, you install PostgreSQL-8.4, and bam, it's available out of the box. So that has taken a lot of the pressure off of the installs that I deal with who are kind of Red Hat centric. One thing. So if you're not aware of that and you are running on Red Hat stuff, you can go get 8.4, and there's even some work moving forward now to make it a little bit easier to take advantage of features like PG upgrade, which do require that you have two versions of Postgres at least temporarily installed to work properly. So 8.3 above for anything new or you're asking for is basically. Default configuration. I apologize for the links. All of the links on this thing just changed to barely readable text right before I did this, which is annoying. All of the slides for the conference, at least from the people who present here well enough to know the drill, normally get uploaded within a day or so after the presentations get done. So if you look at the slide and I'm carrying that right now, the conference website will have a version of this whole set of slides on it not too long from now, and then you can go click directly on it to go read the slide. Default configuration. Some people think, well, the default configuration for PostgreSQL surely is intended to be a useful default configuration, right? Well, no, that's wrong. The default configuration for Postgres is absolutely terrible and useful for almost no one. So you might ask, well, what the hell? Why are Postgres developers such goddamn morons that they make the default configuration useless? It turns out that we blame the Linux kernel developers for this mostly. There are parameters in Linux, and this is true for all the Unix-derived operating systems. I'll just pick on Linux because I know the exact details on it. So all of the Unix-derived operating systems have this concept of shared memory. It's a block of memory that you allocate that then lots of different processes are going to talk to and all use a portion of. So when you start up Postgres, it allocates a large block, or it can allocate a large block of shared memory for things, and this is actually where all of the data that gets cached in the database is stored at. So all the clients that are floating around there can get access to it because it's in shared memory. They all can get to it.
Right.
The reason why the Postgres developers like this and why most reliable database configurations use this is having shared memory like this has some significant advantages as far as being able to protect clients from one another. And if a client does do something really terrible, like for example, you ran kill-9 on it, which you should never do, and you caused all sorts of trouble, you can at least figure out what's going on and do something about it. So using shared memory, the kernel developers kind of see this as an antiquated thing that people do that they shouldn't do anymore. The newer replacements for it, though, just don't have the same safety features that Postgres would really like. If you've been dealing with Linux for any period of time, you probably know that safety concerns are not necessarily the top priority in Linux kernel development. So the thing to realize is that the default parameters on this stuff, in Linux for example, only let you allocate 32 megabytes of shared memory by default. That's it. So Postgres will look at what it can do at the beginning, and while we would like the default configuration to use more memory than that, it can't until you fix this kernel tuning problem first. So if you look at the normal guidelines for, well, what would the default configuration be appropriate for, if you reverse it back out, the default configuration is completely sensible and you should not worry about it at all and deploy it like that if your server has 256 megabytes of RAM. Last time I checked, my phone had more RAM than that, so it's probably less powerful than the server. You do need to adjust a number of memory-oriented parameters to work around this, and if you assume the default configuration is correct, it's another one of those things where when you pose problems to the mailing list and say, hey, how come my performance is terrible on this? You know, people say, well, you're using the default configuration, or the default configuration is terrible, followed by a round of people saying, what the hell are you doing? It should be a default configuration that's terrible, followed by a round of finger pointing at the kernel developers again. And the cycle comes. Better just look at the whole website. Just go through it. The link that you can't read here probably is to a good article that myself and some other Postgres contributors have worked on. It's about tuning your PostgreSQL server. It's over on the wiki.
So it's never really occurred to me before, but for those packages that are coming from distributions, why don't they just include them as part of the installation process?
That's an excellent question. I would love Red Hat to be receptive to ideas like let's go change the shared memory that used to be huge by people. Unfortunately, I think they see this as a security issue that clients. Individual clients, if you let them allocate large amounts of shared memory, there's a potential for something resembling a denial of service attack where people can do scary things with shared memory and leave the things behind and that sort of thing.
So not even for like an active milk, depending on the setting to install stuff, you need to be much more familiar with having something that actually those things like services and loading questions.
Yeah.
Actually, it's big loading before you do it.
Yeah. Right, it's a great idea. I mean, the first step to that is we probably should come up with the tool that does what you just described. That's something that I've been working on. So we have a Google summer code student this year who is interested in working on stuff in this area. So we'll see if I can get him to actually do some of the stuff that he needs to get around to. This area would actually be something that would be very useful. At this point, the current level of automation is I have a script that I give out when people complain that this is too hard, that if you run it on a Linux system, it spits out values and you just put them in the kernel configuration and you're done. To try to help you. So the tuning your PostgreSQL server article goes over 15 or so of the common parameters that you really want to consider changing in your Postgres server. been some that people tend to really get excited about and assume that there are things that they don't, so kind of clarify, you know, what is it that does it supposed to do. There's also a utility that I've written, it's just a little rough yet called PGTune. What PGTune does is worry about, it looks at two things. It looks at how much memory is in the server, and if you're running it on a server other than the production one, you can say, well, the server I actually am running this on is this one. They don't necessarily have to be the same. And then it also takes as an input a concept of workload. Common database workloads are, I've got a data warehouse, there's online transaction processing or OLTP, stuff that's kind of optimized for, I'm writing lots of smaller things, but not necessarily running giant queries. You know, and then there's web application, which tends to be a little bit different than any of those other two. So PGTune takes how much memory do I have and what type of workload am I expecting, and spits out a reasonable starting configuration. So if you just really want to be hands-off with something, it'll get you the kind of things that we wish we could put in as the defaults, but unfortunately can't be done because of these kernel things. It does not intend to yet be a really comprehensive tuning for Postgres, but it's a decent start. So what are the major parameters that we definitely want to take a look at? The first one's called shared buffers. Shared buffers is how much memory is dedicated to Postgres for what it calls a Postgres buffer cache. The same sort of concept exists in most databases. A lot of people who have been DBAs with other databases think, well, I'm going to give Postgres most of the memory on the server because it's a database server. That tends not to work out so well for a couple of reasons. One is Postgres uses the operating system cache when it reads and writes things. So it expects that is there, and if you try to tune Postgres to be more like a traditional database server, if you say, well, I'm going to give it all the memory in the server and I'm going to switch it over to use direct I/O and all these other things, it's not going to work out so well. There are going to be things that you didn't expect that are going to get dramatically slower as a result of those changes. The old guideline for shared buffers, we used to tell people, set it to about a fourth of the amount of RAM in the server. It's increasingly becoming not such a useful guideline because due to some architectural limitations within Postgres that we haven't even really completely mapped out the reasons behind yet, shared buffers tops out at around 8 gigabytes. If you set it to bigger numbers than that, what you discover is performance starts to fall off, and you'd be better off letting the operating system manage that chunk of memory. There's a second issue in here, which I have a whole talk devoted about in the main conference section, called the Right Stuff. Periodically, Postgres runs through checkpoints, and checkpoints write all of this data. However big you set shared buffers to, it has to do a reconciliation of all that data with disk. And how complicated that reconciliation is proportional to how big this number is. If you set this thing to, I've got a 64 gigabyte server, I used to read 25%, makes sense. Okay, let's set shared buffers to 16 gigabytes. You're not going to be happy with what happens if you ever do manage to get 16 gigabytes worth of data that needs to be hidden in one checkpoint, it's not going to be good. So the normal effective range for this, the default is going to be around 32 megabytes. There's a significant gain in almost every case going from that to 512 megabytes. Now, some sites stop there for two reasons. One is this checkpoint problem that I just mentioned. Usually around 512 megabytes is when it becomes easier to run into a checkpoint problem. The reason for that is just minutia around how big caches and RAID controllers and other bits of hardware. The other one is if you're running on Windows, we've gotten lots of reports that once you get above 512, it just stops doing anything useful. We know on Linux and Solaris and some of the other popular platforms, you get useful benefits all the way up to 8 gigabytes. Your Windows, it probably tops out at 512. Just one of those quirks of how Postgres on Windows works, the exact reason behind it is not really very well recognized. So this is kind of the range you should be aiming for. If you aim on the low side, that's okay, as long as it's not at the default of 32, you get the majority of the benefit. You know, it's like a lot of things, you probably get 75-80% of the benefit just going from 32 to 512. You know, if you want that extra little bit, consider going up to the multi-gigabyte range. Don't go too crazy with it, though, and do watch out for checkpoints, which I'll talk about a little bit later. The next thing to recognize is that how often checkpoints happen is on a busy server driven by this parameter called checkpoint segments. Here in Robert's talk earlier, he mentioned this briefly as well. Checkpoints happen one of two ways. They either happen because a certain amount of write-ahead raw data has been written to disk, or they happen because some period of time has passed. Now, that period of time defaults to 5 minutes in Postgres. So unless you change something, as long as something has been written, and I only add that caveat because there is an optimization that if you haven't written anything, it won't do a checkpoint because it doesn't need to. If you've written anything at all, you will get a checkpoint at least every 5 minutes, it is the intention. And that's driven by a parameter called checkpoint timeout. Normally, people don't need to change that at the beginning. You need to change it on a really busy system eventually. But what a lot of people need to change very early is checkpoint segments. The reason for that is what's called a write-ahead log segment in Postgres, these files that transactions get written to, they are 16 megabytes by default. And you can change that, but almost no one ever does, and it's probably not a good idea to play around with that number. So unless you go really crazy, they'll always be 16 megabytes. The default value for checkpoint segments is 3. So that means that you will have to do a reconciliation of all of the data that you've got in RAM, in Postgres' shared buffer cache, and the operating system every time you've written 48 megabytes worth of data to disk. That's not very much anymore. Again, it goes back to, if your server has 256 megabytes of RAM, sure, reasonable value. Otherwise, it's probably not. I normally will bump this number up to just 16 reflexively. Giant servers, I've set it to in production as high as 256 before. When you're actually loading new data into the server, even more ridiculously high values are completely reasonable. The main trade-off to realize here is, first off, this is not going to drive your checkpoints completely because the timeout is still in there. At some point, checkpoint segments gets big enough that you tend to have the checkpoints every 5 minutes based on the timing. At that point, further increases to it don't really buy you anything. The main trade-off here is, however big this number is, affects two things. First off, it affects how much disk space is used by the write-ahead log segments that get stored up. And these are these things that are stored in the pg_xlog directory in the database. So transaction logs, xlog, write-ahead log, these are all the same things we're talking about. The bigger you make this number, the more disk space will get used by those things. So if you just go completely bonkers with it and set a big timeout too, particularly in the case where you put the write-ahead log information on a different drive, you can discover it actually, there's a potential for it to run out of disk space. That's not normally the main driver, though. The main driver is when your database crashes for some reason, unexpectedly, it has to be restarted again, maybe you hear a power outage, maybe someone tripped over the core, maybe it just crashed because of a bug, who knows. When the server starts back up again, it goes back to the previous checkpoint and says, okay, let me look at all of the write-ahead log data that's happened since the last checkpoint and make sure everything's reconciled and consistent with disk and I'm happy with the state of things. How long that process, which is called recovery, takes is proportional to how long it's been since the last checkpoint. So if you make checkpoint segments really high, and to make the problem even worse, if you start changing the timeouts and stuff like that, you can get into a situation where that recovery time is actually significant. Like it can take many minutes for that to happen. I have had post-crash recovery take 4 hours before on a system that, because of some misconfiguration issue, had 8,000 write-ahead log segments it had to replay when it started happening. So replay time of write-ahead log data, it's not funny, it does pile up. It's normally not a problem for people, it's just, this is why you don't want to go too crazy with just going, well, it gets faster if I increase this number, so let's just keep making the number big and not anymore. So it's the brief intro to checkpoint. The third thing that almost every site ends up setting is this thing called effective cache size. Effective cache size doesn't allocate memory. It's not, you need to be concerned about whether you're going to run out of RAM if you make it too big. Effective cache size is used for internal decisions about whether or not the database optimizer thinks that it will be able to fit an index into RAM. So when it's deciding how expensive it is to use this index, it looks at how big the index is relative to this number, and it makes some decisions about it. It's got this scary method it uses based on some mathematical foundations. In practice, this ends up impacting some types of query plans where you're using inner index scans on joins. You know, there's a couple of technical spots that pops up, but the idea is if you've got this set to default, which is a completely trivial 128 megabytes, Postgres will think that any index bigger than 128 megabytes is probably too big to fit in RAM, and therefore it may not want to use it. That's probably not what you want. Again, unless you're running Postgres on a really cheap phone. Normally, the idea here is to set an effective cache size. The reason why the concept is effective cache size is since Postgres uses both its internal caching as well as the operating system caching, the idea is this is how big the operating system cache underneath this thing is approximately. And that's normally on most dedicated database servers that ends up being around 3/4 of RAM. So that's the kind of starting values people will put on a brand new server. If you wanna fine-tune it to actually be more accurate, what you do is you start the server up, you start your application, you put some non-trivial load on it, and you actually look at how big is the amount of data that is framed or being cached by the operating system right now while you're running that workload. You add them together and bam, there's your effective cache size number. The 3/4 number is just extracted from a lot of people have done that at some point. They went, it's normally around 3/4 somewhere. This also makes sense when you consider that the old guideline for shared buffers was 1/4 of RAM. If you're using 1/4 of RAM as dedicated memory to Postgres, it's going to be about 3/4 left over 3/4 stuff. The final parameter that's in the really critical and completely wrong by default, and you have to be careful about it, category is this thing called workmem. Workmem is also not a explicit allocation of memory. If you set workmem to a value, it doesn't go allocate that memory by default. It uses it for different type of computation. So what happens is there are a couple of types of operations that Postgres will do where it needs working memory in order to do something. The two most common somethings are if you're sorting data, it needs to store the information that it's sorting somewhere. And actually used to be called Swordmen in older versions of PostgreSQL because that was almost exclusively what it was used for. The other thing that it gets used for is becoming increasingly more popular starting in 8.4, which is it'll use it for making decisions about hash tables. Hash tables are the compact representations of the important parts of some query that you're running that are needed to make decisions about things. So a hash table might, for example, contain the list of primary keys for the table that you're joining to another table. You don't really need to store the whole table if the only thing you were going to use it for was deciding whether or not there's a matching join. You can just save a hash table instead and save yourself a bunch of trouble by doing that. Hash tables also get used for derived computations, and they get used for things like.
Vacuum also use working memory.
Now, auto vacuum uses a slightly different parameter that's named maintenance role.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And those are not really related other than the similarities in the name. So WorkMem, the hash tables that it uses are increasingly being used for things like if you want the distinct values from something. Or even if you want to sort things, you'll discover that it ends up deciding, oh, wait a minute, I have a way I can efficiently implement this using a hash table instead. And hash tables are usually very fast and therefore preferred by a lot of the situations that they can end up getting used. But what this means is that increasingly in newer versions of Postgres, it is making more and more decisions about whether or not it can use the faster ways to execute a query, which involve things like hash tables, based on whether or not it thinks it will fit in memory, and that decision is all driven by WorkMem. So the thing to realize about WorkMem is why you can't just go crazy and set to a big number. WorkMem is not just allocated per connection. It's allocated per what's called a query node. So when you execute a query, let's say it's sorting something and then joining the sorted version over to something else, that's multiple operations inside the query plan. It's got one that's actually reading the data, it's got one that's sorting the data, and it's got one that's going to be reading the data from the other table, and then it's got one that's going to be joining the results from those two things together. They actually fit together in a tree. So when you allocate WorkMem, every individual node in that tree, every operation, could theoretically use WorkMem or the memory. So it's not really a very good bound at all. So the question you have to ask yourself is, well, on the query workload that I have, how many of these sorting operations typically end up happening? Or how many of these hashing things end up happening? It's kind of a hard number to measure accurately in most cases. Normally, the guidelines that I ended up coming up with that seemed to work pretty well while developing PGTune said, well, let's take the total amount of RAM in the server, let's divide it by the number of connections, and then we need an additional number to divide it by that's kind of a, what's the expected number of concurrent WorkMem operations that might be happening on any given query, and the range of that number has typically ended up being about 4 to 32 is where you get started on these queries. So 4 would be the right kind of number if you've got, say, big data warehouse that doesn't really have all that many connections to it anyway, but the connections that are running are processing giant chunks of data that they really need a lot of work in. 32 would be a more appropriate number for I've got a web application and, you know, the number of users like varies around a lot and I want to be a little paranoid about that. And the queries that they're running are not really all that sensitive to whether WorkMem is usefully or not. So that's kind of where those numbers come from. I'll talk a little bit later about what I tend to prefer on this stuff, which is if work mem is set too low, you can see evidence of that fact set in logs. So if you go looking for that information in logs instead, you can set it conservatively and then look for evidence that you've set it too low and then increase it based on that evidence. I always prefer these sort of iterative approaches where you get in reasonable range but on the low side and then monitor the system to figure out if you're too low and then use that feedback to go up from there. And WorkMem works very well for that. Last bit of trivia for this section about WorkMem. WorkMem, actually effective cache size is also in this category, but typically not fiddled around in this fashion. You can set WorkMem for a query. Any query is allowed to set WorkMem before they run. So the server does not enforce WorkMem on the clients. The client can say, I need WorkMem to be this giant number to execute correctly. So what ends up happening in a lot of places is they will set WorkMem for particular queries that are running giant reports to values that are higher than it would really be safe to set the entire server to. So you might have an overnight batch report or some sort of weekly summary or something like that you look at and go, man, I look at this query plan and I gotta give it a gigabyte of working memory to get the query plan that executes this thing correctly. A gigabyte is a completely reasonable WorkMem setting for a giant report to run, but you can't set WorkMem to gigabyte in the PostgreSQL.com because then every query operation on every node on every connection could end up using a gigabyte of RAM. You're almost certainly going to crash into your amount of memory if you do that sort of thing. So setting WorkMem, it can be difficult sometimes to figure out where in the hell do I actually set this thing in. I forget the exact version, but one of the newer Postgres versions, it might have been 9.0, you can actually tweak this stuff on a per-user basis, where you can make it when this particular user who runs the reports or something like that gets his own custom set of Postgres settings. This is a good candidate for something to tweak in there. There are a lot of these query optimizer things that you can adjust on a per-user basis in order to get good query plans out that you may want to make them very specific to the query that's running.
About the connections in your calculation, I've seen that a lot of people tend to put a real Big Max connection value.
Mm-hmm.
Is the calculation more based towards the max connections or towards the effective number of connections that would be on the database?
That's a good question. So the question is, do you set this based on the actual max connections or the effective average number of connections? The answer is somewhere in the middle, because you may set this to a larger number than you would normally like so the idea is this is intended to work off the max connections of the data. It's like the hard limit, and this is trying to get safe numbers, even if every single client is connected to doing something. That's the intention here. It may very well be the case with your workload, you may find yourself, if you really start getting detailed, this is not something you just want to do off the cuff, but if you need to, you can do things like say, well, look, I've got 500 connections to this database, and I know that these 10 users over here, they have queries that they run that need more work than the things that the other users do. And because of the way my architecture is built, there's never ever going to be more than 10 of these executing at once. And all of the other 500 are executing simple queries, right? So like that's the sort of thing that you're talking about is, well, what if some of the users are just different or the number of them you get at once is not the same? You may be able to get away with setting WorkMem to a higher value than you could support if every client was running a big computation, you might be able to get away with that if, because of your workload, you know, well, it's never actually going to be the case. I'll never get more than 10 users running this giant query, so the fact that I need to set one of them higher for it, I'll do that globally, knowing that there are not that many of them are ever actually going to show up in the query. It's kind of a dangerous game to play, but also you can do it. Setting this up for user in versions that becomes available, I think, is probably what people want to do with this in the long parameter. They want this entire everyone wants this entire mechanism to go away and replace myself. So, sorry for these questions. As I said, the tuning the PostgreSQL server goes over about four times as many parameters. It starts with these and goes into a bunch of other ones. But these are the things that, if you get them, that they will almost certainly be wrong out of the box, and you will almost certainly will suffer performance problems if you don't know something about them. But just getting them into the right sort of ballpark, either by hand using the instructions in the tuning guide on the wiki, or running pgtune to spit them back out again, will get you to the point where you're more likely to run into some other problem than to run into one of these limitations is the first thing that we can identify. Table statistics. This has already been touched on if you were in the earlier talk today. So table statistics are sometimes the answer to one of the more popular performance questions that pop up, which is, well, why didn't this query use an index? So there's a couple of reasons why a query can fail to use an index. The simplest one is simply the fact that it's not actually any faster. Postgres uses a model that says, at some point, if I'm touching a percentage of the data in this database, using the index isn't really going to help me, because we're going to have to go look at basically every single row in this database anyway. If you think about it, if you're accessing, let's say on average, you can put 100 rows of your data in each of the blocks of the database uses. If you're accessing more than 1% of the data in that situation, it's possible you're going to have to touch every single row in that database, because you get 1% of them here, you get 1% of them here, and next thing you know, you touch 100% of them. So that phenomenon is really not that bad, but it's there. So the default tuning on the database, the number ends up coming out as in the neighborhood of 20%. So if you're touching more than 20% of the data in a table, you're probably going to get a sequential scan no matter what you do. And that's really what you want, because indexes are not free. They do require overhead, and the way Postgres works, it can't answer queries just based on the index anyway. It has to go look at the data to figure out whether or not the data is visible in order to return it back. So it can't do yet what are called index-only scans in some other databases that support them. And index-only scans would make it possible for Postgres to use indexes in more situations for like images. That's what I mean. There was an excellent talk by Bruce Monchi in the main conference session called The Magic of MVCC. Going to be a talk I would recommend going to if you're interested in why it is that it does have to go from the table at the time. Bruce gets into all the details of that sense as well. So sometimes when you get an index, it's because you're looking at so much of the data that Postgres says, well, you don't want to use an index, I got to go look at the whole table anyway, so I'm going to use this sequential scan. Second possibility is if the table is really small, you're probably going to get a sequential scan even if you have an index on it, because just the way the math works out for really small tables, it becomes difficult to justify reading an index block in the memory for stuff that fits in a couple of databases. You know, if you've only got one or two database blocks in the whole thing, the index is just wasting time. You'll just go read the thing instead. It knows that won't be too expensive. So those are two kind of odd edge cases. But once you get out of the trivial situation, the most common thing that causes things to not use an index are bad statistics on the database. Statistics get calculated whenever you run what's called the analyze step on the database. You can run analyze by hand on the table. Auto vacuum runs in the background all the time. We'll also make decisions about analyzing. The terminology here is somewhat unfortunate. There is both the analyze command and vacuum command. Vacuum, most people know, is a big intensive process. There's also a vacuum analyze command, and auto vacuum does both vacuum and analyze. So some people think vacuum and analyze are similar sort of operations. They're not, in the respect that analyze normally takes a fairly small amount of time. Bigger databases, it can take, you know, a couple of minutes to run, but it's not going to run for hours like vacuum can run a database. So being able to run analyze on something, if you're looking at a query and you're going, this data doesn't seem like it matches my underlying data, you shouldn't be too afraid to just go run an analyze, see if that helps. You know, you'll get a slight, analyze is randomly sampling the data, so you'll definitely get a different set of data in there to begin with. That may be enough to make the problem go away. Or if you just haven't analyzed it recently enough, it may help. So don't be afraid to run that. The other unfortunate terminology bit here is the thing that you use in Postgres to find out how a query is actually executing is called explain analyze. The fact that that also uses the word analyze is not directly reflected in by that. It's not supposed to be just that those depend upon one another. It's just analyze is kind of a generic term for give me more detail about the explain. The thing that you want to do to get an idea, hey, wait a minute, maybe my statistics are wrong for this thing, is there's, whenever you run something in explain and analyze, it actually runs the query and shows you what it was expecting to happen in the query versus what actually happened in the query. And those numbers will include estimates. It'll say things like, you know, expected equals 10,000 rows, actual equals 1,000,000 rows. You see stuff like that? The query planner has possibly made a terrible decision based on bad statistics. Last one I ran into on the production server, it was because someone was running a benchmark and they ran analyze at the beginning of the benchmark and then loaded a bunch of data into the table and then they ran all their queries. It was actually using the statistics that had been generated when there were almost no rows on the table and kind of extrapolating from those for the newer workload that was involving, and that didn't really work out so well. So don't be afraid to run analyze. Don't be afraid to look at explain analyze output. Just recognize that you will run the query when you run explain analyze. So however long the query takes to run, you're going to have to wait that long. And you can run explain analyze on things that do updates or deletes or things that are called functions, aka stored procedures. So if you do something in your query that actually makes changes to the database and run it on explain analyze, it's still going to make changes to the database when it runs. It's just going to give you timing information back again. If you see this variation, if the estimated numbers and the actual look wrong, the first thing to try is to try increasing what's called the statistics target. The statistics target is this number for how many samples it collects and how many buckets worth of data it puts it in. The idea behind the statistics is it actually collects up buckets of data that are in a histogram that say things like, well, this percentage of the data looks like this, and this percentage of the data looks like this. And then when you ask it, well, what percentage of the rows are to match this thing, it tries to estimate that using the data that's got the buckets. It's problematic to increase the statistics number across the whole database in some cases because putting a huge number on the statistics collected, it slows down analyze, which most people don't care about. It slows down the queries a little bit too. Whenever whenever you're on a query, it has to go look through all this statistics data and decide, what do I want to do? How do I want to execute this thing? So the more data there is sitting in that thing that it needs to consider, the longer it will take to plan the query. Now, that may be fine, but in some situations, particularly web applications tend to be sensitive to this stuff. You don't want the query plan to take a long time to execute. You want it to just get it over with and go execute the query already. And so putting the statistics on the giant thing just to solve query planning problems essentially shifts the problem of what am I going to do with this stuff from, okay, you may get a slow query plan to you're definitely going to get a slow planning operation out of the whole thing. So be careful with that. Because of that, in a lot more cases than I think I see, what would really make sense, if you're in this situation where you've said, well, here's a query, the query plan is bad, and it's bad because its statistics are wrong on this thing, they explain as this number, as this number. You shouldn't reflexively go, well, let's increase default statistics target across the whole database. The first question I suggest you consider instead is it just that one column on that database that just has kind of a funny distribution or there's something odd about it? If that's the case, you can increase the statistics just on that one column. Queries involving that column are going to have a little bit more data to process because of this overhead, but you're not going to be collecting a huge amount of statistics you don't need on every column anymore. And so this will let you get the benefit of speeding up the queries that are problematic without paying so much of the overhead for this giant collection of query stuff that's going to make.
That's a good question. What's a good, ratio
Probably a factor of 10, the classic order of magnitude. If it's 2 or 3 off or something like that, it's probably not going to be a huge issue. The big problem, and this is the big problem for database optimization in general, is it's really hard sometimes to estimate how selective an index is, or how selective a query is on something. So if you say, give me all of the values for, x equals 3, if it has statistics on how often does x equals 3 appear in the data set, and it tries to collect that data, and it may have answers on 3, it'll give you a pretty exact number back. If it doesn't, what it'll do in cases where it just doesn't have any idea sometimes is it'll say, well, I have this much data that I have no idea about, and this is one value out of that set, so let's assume an even distribution of all the rest of the stuff. And so those numbers can be really off. Like, for example, if you've got a value that appears, 3 times in a giant table, and Postgres doesn't happen to run into a sample on the analyze, it's probably not, it's a rare value. Postgres is going to look at it and say, well, this looks like it's part of the 5% of the data that I haven't seen. It's not stored in my buckets of frequent values and stuff like that. So it may assume it's like an even percentage of that based on the range that it's got, but it can easily be off by a significant multiple in the case where it has no idea what's going on. So the thing that's nice about setting the bigger values for the statistics target is the buckets, as far as the ranges for these things, start getting smaller, so the amount of like really weird data that it has to assign for, I don't know, it's somewhere in this range, starts dropping. But it's getting a hard number on that, it really is kind of data dependent. What you'll normally discover is that the numbers are either they're in 3 categories. They're either really surprisingly close sometimes. So if you look at it and go, wow, I knew exactly how many rows were in there. That's only what happens when you've got so much analyzed statistics data that it literally has accounted, there are exactly this many rows that match x equals 3, and it spits it right back at me. Then this case where it just gives gives you like a way high number, like factor of 100 or more off or something like that. The cases in the middle, you know, factor of 2 to factor of 10, like those are where it starts getting hard to do, and it may not be possible to solve that problem completely with statistics, but increasing statistics can make it less likely that you'll run into the nastier of the edge cases.
Is there a way to make it change how we determine the sample?
No. Analyze does its thing. The only real input on the analyze process is this target for how much data it's going to store if it's not. In earlier versions of Postgres, the default statistics target was 10, which is pretty ridiculous as far as how little data it collects on your server. Again, it made sense a long time ago. Starting at 8.4, it's moved up to 100. 100 is actually a pretty good value for a lot of databases. If you're out of the box and your number's at 100, you're probably going to be fine. If you've got a 100 gigabyte database, you're probably not going to be fine at 100 on everything anymore. But I mean, you only have a few gigabytes in the database, you're just getting started. I would not be concerned with this statistical target is something you've got to go crazy optimizing out of the box. The normal useful range for it is 100 to 1,000-ish. I think in 8.4 you can only set it to, or in 8.3 you can only set it to 1,000, and then it bumped to 10,000 in 8.4. There is an upper limit on it to be concerned about. I say 100 to 1,000 is the normal useful range because what happens if you start setting it to multiple thousands is this query overhead time starts getting a little bit ugly. The query overhead time, there are components to it that are actually proportional to the target squared. So that number grows really big when you get to some types of large data sets. It doesn't impact most things that people do, but if you start pushing your luck by trying to set this number into the 10,000 range, you're probably going to run into that. So I run a lot of servers with 200, you know, 500, something like that. I start getting nervous if we go in that this needs to be 1,000 or more. As such, if it really does need to be 1,000 or more, that's definitely where you want to start thinking about, well, let's make this a targeted thing. Let's make it 5,000 on this column. Because you can't set it that high database-wide, but it is possible you may need to set it to a higher value of 1,000 for a specific column. This has got a really weird distribution of the data or some other dynamic stuff. So this example here, a lot of people think that that's going to be a complicated thing to do. It's that simple. You just alter the table and say, set the statistics, that number, and you're done. From then on, it will just automatically go in and collect that many more statistics when it runs analyzed instead of whatever the default number is. If you're really bonkers, you can even do things like set the statistics number to a lower value than the default from tables you don't want to collect numbers on, and you want to expect results on that. I don't think I've ever seen anything like that. If you look at PGStat user tables, which is one of the things that's going to pop up quite a bit here in this talk, it will give you timestamps for both when the last time analyzed was run manually and the last time the analyzed was run by automatically. These things only appeared in Postgres 8.3 as part of the factors in why 8.3 is a better release for a lot of performance reasons. That automatically is extracted from a lot better version. You can look at the statistics data. It's not complete black magic. It's only mostly black magic. You can look at these MCVs, these most common values. You can look at these histograms. And if you know your data and you look at the statistics, it should make sense to you. It may be a little more math than you really want to get wrapped up in, but it's not like this is magic data and it's going to be optimized and you can't do anything with it. I've had clients of mine who were surprised when I dumped the data out of PGStats for the thing that the query is wrong on. They'll look at it, and their expecting that this is going to be data that they just can't do anything with. And they look at it and go, oh, wait, I see what the problem is. It's missing this entire type of data that's in the database. Oh, why doesn't it see that? Oh, okay, it needs more statistics to figure that out. Or it hasn't been analyzed recently enough. Last time it was analyzed was before that type of data appeared. So, you know, it's not the first thing I would recommend, but if you're getting to the point where you're saying, hey, my estimates are off by so much that I think maybe I've got a statistics problem, I would suggest you do not be afraid to go look at PG Stats. It's kind of a pain to navigate and get the information out of, just as far as fitting it on the screen is annoying. But the data itself is not really all that complicated. I will normally dump it to a text file and then load the text file in with an editor to be able to navigate the whole thing. It is worth your trouble, especially if you really want to look like a super Postgres guru. If you get good at using PG Stat stuff and people ask you questions about why does this query run, and you answer them with things like, well, this query is slow because the selectivity is poor on this most common value feature, and therefore it's falling back to the equal histogram thing. People will assume you really want to. So it's good for job screening, too, if you have this sort of information. Or even better, if you're a consultant. So statistics stuff is important, and it is not as scary as it seems. The documentation is somewhat cryptic, but if you go look at PG Stats, you may discover it's easier than you expected to figure it out, and I do recommend that people take a look at that stuff. Vacuum happens after a couple of things. When you insert a row into Postgres, that's great. That goes in there, and that doesn't cause any future problems. When you delete a row, what that does under the hood is it says this row is no longer visible as of this particular transaction ID. And because it's possible that there may be queries running that still need to see the old version of that row, it can't just overwrite it immediately. This is central to the MVCC concept that I was commenting, you'll hear more than you ever want to know about if you show your Bruce's talk. So when you delete something, it just says, this is no longer visible at this point in time. You can't actually remove it from disk until later. The same thing happens with update. Update is actually the most intensive single row thing that you can do, because update both has to go to the original row and say, you're not visible as of this date, as of this transaction. And it has to go create a new row somewhere else with the new version of the data. And then both of those rows are still visible in parallel. And what vacuum does is it goes and it finds these things that are left behind by updates and deletes. They're called dead rows within the server, and it cleans them up. So how does it decide what it's going to do? Well, there's a background process that is available in earlier versions, but it doesn't really get automatic by any stretch until Postgres 8.3. Auto vacuum will update the database statistics we were talking about, and it will also clean up after these things. It works off of a threshold concept. The idea is it tracks how many changes have been made to the database since it last did auto vacuum or vacuum, and then when that number is above a threshold, it does something. The computation of it is a little bit weird for small tables, but the easy way to remember it is, if it's a non-trivial table, it will run auto vacuum when 20% of it is changed. That may actually be bigger than you want. If the problem here is 20%. Can be a lot on a big table. And so somewhat paradoxically, you may discover that the thing with 20% was fine when it was a small table, but now that it's a giant table that's a huge amount of work to vacuum, I need it to vacuum more often because 20% of it is just, you know, way too big of a number if I let that much vary. Vacuum is intensive when it happens. And you can't put it off forever. There is this concept of a transaction ID number in Postgres. It can only get to about 2 billion before the database has to do some internal cleanup to reuse those transaction ID numbers. It's a process called freezing. And so it takes transaction IDs that it definitely doesn't have to care about the visibility information on anymore, and replaces it by what's called the frozen transaction ID. So the thing is, you can put off regular vacuum. You can't put off frozen transaction ID cleanup, because if that number ever rolls over inside the database, you're done. You can't start the database anymore. You can't process transactions. So even if you turn auto vacuum off and you've done all sorts of things to try to stop auto vacuum from running, it will still do transit. It'll still do frozen transaction ID cleanup when that threshold is crossed. And that threshold is actually 200 million by default. So it will start kicking in and trying to do this when it's only gotten to 10% of the point where it absolutely must do it with the database server crash. It's a little critical. So the bad cycle that some people get into with Postgres is they'll run the server, and then one day auto vacuum will kick in. It'll have 20% of a reasonably large database to clean up. It'll be really intensive. Like, the server will get hammered. You know, people are complaining. The phones are ringing. Why is the server so slow? So people go, oh my god, vacuum sucks. Let me turn that off. So that works fine for a little bit. And then one day, frozen transaction ID kicks in.
Dun, dun, dun.
And now, the magnitude of the problem that you've got is probably at least 10 times as big as the one you had the first time you started. And you can't stop it, no matter what you do. So you don't want to do that. What you want to do is, it's possible to take auto vacuum and put limits on it. It has these things it calls cost parameters. They're not in good human-readable units. It's not like it says, oh, only use this many megabytes per second. It works in theoretical costs with estimates for how much work a page takes and stuff like that. You're going to have to practice a bit to get the right numbers for your workload, but you need to do it while you've got a smaller database. And you want to get some practice with this, because when you've got a giant database, it's going to be much more difficult to do. So the concept is not, let me delay this, because you can't delay it forever. All you can do is make the problem much worse by delaying. What you can do, though, is you can try to smooth it out and make the whole thing not be as intensive when it runs. So really high-volume sites will end up in this situation where the vacuum is basically always running at a really low intensity doing something like that. Because you can never get to a situation where you can let it spike, but if there's enough churn in your database, there's always something that needs to clean up. You also can combine this concept with some manual vacuuming. Like, if you know, hey, wait a minute, my workload is typically lower at this point in time, you can say, well, let's launch a manual vacuum with this cost limit and intensity that's a little bit different than the automatic one, and let's let it go a little bit harder at the server during this window than it would during the rest of the time. And there's even, like, in Simon's book here, he's even got a little recipe for crazy things like changing around settings in PostgreSQL.com to have the server is, mission performance critical, and a server can do more maintenance number, and actually switch the PostgreSQL.com settings based on what time of the day you're in or whatever it's like. Not only will delaying the problem make the problem worse, this dead row stuff, these things, they cost you something. The dead rows in the background, even though they're not active anymore, when you're scanning information in the database to try to run queries, those things are slowing down. And that slowdown is adding up the more and more dead rows you've got. And the word word that gets used for this a lot is we call it bloat. You know, bloat is a chunking table that's just not actually used anymore. And bloat can end up becoming significant. The thing that you don't want to do is something I ran into at a former company at one point. We'd accidentally added a bug to the version of Postgres we were shipping to a customer. They caused Vacuum to never run, and when we finally realized what was going on, there was actually a terabyte of a dead rose in the database. Don't do that. That's really bad.
How many non-dead rows were there in that database?
200 gigabytes.
Yeah.
Exactly. All right, so question first.
Okay, I'm just trying to get this straight. Maybe I missed something, but if I'm updating or deleting a row, you said that might be needed in that another transaction. Like how would I be allowed to update or delete a row that's being used by another transaction?
The whole underlying implementation in Postgres, this thing called multi-version concurrency control, everybody gets their own version of the row in situations where multiple versions are needed. That's actually how it ends up working under the hood. So you can have two versions of a row. This one's visible to this transaction, this one's visible to this transaction.
And then when that transaction ends, then it's no longer visible if that
query is done. Ends and all other transactions from that era end, and then it can go clean it up, but it has to wait for all the transactions.
Okay, so what if I have sensitive data that must be deleted now, and I don't even want to, like, I guess if you're doing that vacuum, before you do that vacuum, I guess there must be a way to get that data back.
That's, yes.
So what if it's sensitive information that must be revoked forever, and I don't have time to wait for a vacuum operation?
Yeah, you'll be hard-pressed to eliminate data from a database that you can't recover it by doing an operating system level dump of that data page. That's actually the hard thing. Even if Postgres released it back to the operating system, there's no guarantees the way Postgres does I/O that the operating system is actually really going to overwrite the original copy. For example, if you're using a file system like a ZFS, ZFS does something that's called copy on write. When you write something back out again, it also makes a new version of the thing, and the old version is still there. It just, after it's finished the new one, it stops making it available, but that thing is still surrounded. Doing secure deletion on writes, there's an operating system layer to that as well, and that makes it difficult for Postgres to really enforce anything. So even if I told you, here's what you can do to make absolutely sure of what Postgres is going to do, because Postgres is doing all its I/O through the operating system, you'd be hard-pressed to be absolutely sure it's not still on the disk if someone developed the file system.
Yeah, even dropping the table with just unlinked the files on the file system, they'd still be available if you actually went and pulled through the I/O table as well.
And if you take your disk drive out of your database and you ship it to somebody, they can even recover blocks that have been overwritten on the disk if you're willing to pay enough money for it.
I understand, but it is
something you may want to look at. And if this is a concern, you definitely want to receive Bruce's talk, because he actually talks about mechanics of this. Give me 1 second. You had a question over there. It was our next one.
Just a quick one.
Well, not two shadow rows, you've got the original row that's just been marked deleted.
Does that mean that if you do updates, there's two rows that are impacted by the update, would that mean that would count twice as much as...
No, it's the new ones that get added are what gets used for that counter. And I glossed over one thing here as well, which is... The threshold for updates and deletes triggers vacuum when that many updates or deletes have happened. It's like, okay, we're over 20% of the table relative down the rows, let's do that. Whether it's going to do analyze or not is actually also considers inserts as well, because your database statistics will get Postgres keeps some internal counters for how many rows have I updated or deleted. You know, you can actually see them you can see some form of them in PGStat user tables. There's actually alive and dead rows counter. And that number is what I actually do.
See you next time.
Talking about the new Postgres, is there any online operations you do to remove the rows from the table? Because you had a transaction that was running for table two, and then you're stuck.
We'll talk about that. Science talk about that. So that's a major discussion for our pending break. So,
yeah. Is the 20% change required a global study, or can you apply to a specific table?
It's also a table level. So you can say, okay, 20% is the global number, now go alter this table and set the auto vacuuming percentage the threshold to 5% is this kind of requirement. We're halfway through, so I'm going to take a break here for a couple of minutes, let everybody run out, and then I'll get to the end of this. This slide is always the spot where the questions come out, so I put it right in. So you start running into vacuum issues. The question you should start asking yourself is, well, how do I know when I'm running into these problems? The first thing that you can do on the hierarchy shell, look at PGStat user tables. There are both timestamps in there. They are not always perfect. There are conditions under which you'll discover that number is wrong, but you did something new. So, but it should at least give you a better idea than having no information to work with. There's a log entry internally called log auto vacuum duration. That thing will make it such that every time auto vacuum does run, if it took more than a certain amount of time, it will log it. The idea is, and this is a recurring one for a lot of Postgres sessions, you want to set that number where it doesn't annoy you with trivial data. Like, if auto vacuum runs for 2 seconds against the Postgres database, you probably don't care. But if it runs for an hour against another database, you ought to do. So getting that number where it logs with one another without being really chatty and just throwing stuff at the time, maybe something between. There's a serious problem you can run into with vacuum, which is that because of this visibility information, if you've got a transaction that opens up and starts doing something, and then that session keeps that transaction open, it can't clean up past that point in time to do vacuum. And that's not that table, that's the whole database. It's stuck at the point in time at which that memory and transactions happen. So if you've got one of those things floating around, the longer that memory transaction is there, you're just going to keep dead rows piling up further and further. Love this layer shirt. Another thing that you should definitely pay attention to is how big your tables and indexes are. There are functions available that will get you how big the tables are and how big the indexes are. Postgres calls both of them relations. The idea is a relation is either a table or an index or something like that. So if you, one of the things that tends to happen when databases get out of whack is either the disk space on the table itself gets completely out of control over time, or the disk space used by the index does. And what will sometimes happen is when you create the database, the index will be one size relative to the table, and then it runs into trouble. So the link, the barely visible link to the wiki this time is a page that includes some samples for checking disk space views. Those actually look like this. So they just look over all of the relations using PG class just one of the internal views. It looks at it with the namespace. And then the functions, they're called the PG relation size and PG total relation size. Later versions of Postgres, it's even non-memory one, added a new variation just called the PG table size. It's also helpful. The idea is if you do this, you'll find out what are actually the big users of disk space. And if you have a database, you've been moving in data, you've never run this query, you're really missing out because finding out exactly where all the disk space in the server is in status. Really shocking. People wasn't really expected. And the ratio of how big the indexes are relative to the tables is kind of interesting. You will sometimes look at an index and go, wait a minute, this index is bigger than the table. No wonder it's not ever using it. Stuff like that. Indexes have a related problem here called index order. It's similar but not exactly the same as the table. The idea is when you delete something out of an index, theoretically at some point that block of the index should be able to get reused. It should be able to get back to the operating system. The problem is, in order for that to work, you actually have to delete everything that's in that chunk of the index, and that is not always practical to do. So what can happen as you delete stuff out of the database over time is the index blocks become what's referred to as sparse, where they've only got a little bit of data in each of the blocks. So to read the same amount of data, you used to be able to read in a small number of blocks. You have to go through a lot of blocks as it's kind of spread out. There's a command called vacuum full that's generally a bad idea to run. Before PostgreSQL 9.0, when you ran vacuum full, it helped with table bloat eventually after running for a really long time. And it actually made index bloat worse. So if you ran vacuum full and you were only looking at the table sizes, you might have declared the operation a success. Had you looked at the index sizes too, you would have realized, wait a minute, I actually just made the index problem worse. And the indexes are often a limiting factor on things. So one way to end up with an index that doesn't get used to the query is run vacuum full. Vacuum full has been rewritten in Postgres 9.0 to do an operation that before then was referred to as cluster. What cluster does is it recovers from all of these problems at once. And the way it does it is it literally writes a new copy of the table. When you run cluster on something, it grabs a strong lock on it, so no one can really do anything with that table anymore. And it just starts reading through the whole table, it writes a new copy of the table, it rebuilds all the indexes on the table, it just does a fresh copy of it, and then when it's done, it does an atomic swap at commit time over to the new copy of the table. So if you've got a database, and when you first loaded it, it was really slow, it was really fast, and you've been using it for a while, it just seems to be getting slower. And maybe someone tries, well, I'm going to dump and reload it in another system. Oh wow, now it's fast, what's going on? You can get that same effect, that really fresh feel of, I just put the data in there and it's all compacted together, you know, all the indexes are nice and cool. You can get that just with cluster without actually having to do the dump and reload step. So particularly if you've done something terrible that's caused vacuum not to run way too long, or you're the idiot who got a terabyte of data in the database or something, cluster can just fix all those problems. How long cluster takes to run is proportional to how big the data that's left is, not how big the data is right now. So if you've got a lot of dead data in it, it's just going to read the live data out and write it. So it's quite possible cluster won't even take as long as you expected it to if a ton of the data is actually all garbage and bloated stuff that nobody's using. If you've got index bloat, but you suspect you don't have table bloat, or you, and because, for example, you did something in vacuum full, it's possible to just rebuild an index using the reindex command is the first way you can do it. Re-index also takes some fairly strong locks on things, and you're probably not going to be able to do it in a way that makes you happy. If you can afford to re-index things, you may discover you just want to recluster the whole thing because they're both going to require some sort of downtime to do. So the little non-obvious trick that people end up doing in 24/7 shops, when you create a new index, it has the option where you can create it concurrently. And that does some little shuffling behind the scenes that will create the index while caching other activity happening on the table, and then it can update the changes that has happened while the index was running. So this gets you an index that's all compacted up nicely, and is very efficient, and then it'll have the new stuff kind of tacked onto it afterwards when it's done. So that's normally good enough to recover from some pretty bad ideas. The thing to realize is that you can run it concurrently, and then when it's done, DDL changes the table structure and whatnot. Postgres are all transactional. You can start up a transaction, drop the old index, and then rename the old the new index to whatever the old one had, and commit that little thing, and you just simulated what re-index concurrently would do if there was such a thing. So there's an example of that in exactly how to do it in Simon's book. It's not too terribly difficult to figure out. It's just a matter of regaining the table. So if you do want to rebuild just an index for something, and index rebuilding is not a weird behavior. If you're deleting stuff in kind of an odd pattern, it's an expected behavior. It's something you will need to do eventually under a lot of situations. You may be able to do that with concurrent creation of indexes.
Does that get around the problem if you have functions that expect an index to be there and you change the index? Does that break the function, or you have to rebuild the function?
I don't think the functions ever are dependent upon a particular index being available. It's dependent on a lot of things, but indexing is more of a good sort of implementation. Nobody actually really wants that.
Is he thinking of cache queries actually?
It's possible.
Could be, yeah.
Yeah. So those things you may have to reset those. I'm not exactly sure what happens when you trigger those sort of things out. But, you know, it's definitely the sort of thing you want to test. Works like. And it's also in the category of things I recommend that you experiment with while your database is still small, so you got a feel for kind of how it works and what its limitations are before you're in a situation where you have to use it.
Couple things with cluster. I found it works a lot better, and it's a lot faster if you re-index the table first, or at least the index you're going to have it cluster on, so that's nice and compact. I've gotten tremendous speed up doing that. And secondly, with the re-indexing, my yearbook on their GitHub repository has a nice re-indexing tool to allow you to re-index a table and do everything but the primary key.
Yeah,
all scripted for you.
There are some tools floating around. There's NTT did one called PG Reorg. There's some other ones floating around. There are some people in production 24/7 lots of data environments who've written some tools that work around this particular set of issues. So if this is a problem you're running into, maybe it's not really a solved problem. There are a couple of examples people have worked out that help.
When did we make cluster at CC7?
83.
Well, that was 83.
Yeah. It's one of the many reasons why I try not to get people for 83. Yeah, cluster doesn't really do what you want it to do for 83 in all cases. And the bit of trivia he just alluded to, the difference between cluster and vacuum full in Postgres 9.0, where they are almost the same thing, is that when you run cluster requires you to give it an index, and it resorts that table by whatever index you told it. It physically won't miss it, it puts it like that. So one way you can make it faster is you can make sure that index is itself length efficient before you start the whole operation, because it's going to have to navigate the whole thing. When you do vacuum full in Postgres 9.0, it does the same sort of let's rebuild everything and let's compact the table, but it doesn't do the let's sort it by that index first step. are the highlights that if you're at least aware of the problem, then you should be watching for the way ahead of a lot of these things. Extensions. Extensions are now officially what things that are added to the server that kind of run inside the server itself are called. These are things that are included with PostgreSQL but are not installed and available to you by default. Starting in Postgres 9.1, these are actually super easy to install. You just type create extension and you give the name of the thing to boot up. In earlier versions, it was a little bit harder. You had to go find the thing, and there was some SQL file, and sometimes you had to edit it, and it was messy. So it was possible to install these things before. In Postgres 9.1, it becomes trivial to do it, and that's a great change. One thing to be aware of is that all of these modules, these extensions that they've added, live in what PostgreSQL calls the contrib space, which are kind of, they started as user-contributed modules that got added into the database. Postgres's APIs are such that it's actually very easy to put even a really complicated thing and load it in to the server using the APIs instead. So a lot of things are sitting in contrib simply because they can sit in contrib, and Postgres tries not to put anything in the main core unless it has to be there. So in a lot of operating system packages, this contrib stuff is actually in a separate operating system packet than the rest of the server, and it may not even be installed by default. So one of the things to watch out for is, like, if you're installing Postgres on Linux and you've got the RPMs for Postgres, there is a specific RPM named PostgreSQL-contrib. In later versions, it'll be PostgreSQL 8.4-contrib and 9.0-contrib, whatever. It's not the same package. It's not the same thing as the main server. The main server is not dependent on it, so you can choose to install it or not. So if you have to check for it specifically, it's likely it won't actually be on your server. This is good to know because some of these tools are really helpful, and in a lot of environments, if you didn't install that PostgreSQL contrib package at the point when you built the server, and it wasn't there when you went into QA, you will have serious issues getting someone to install it later. And the fact that the thing has this slightly scary name of contrib doesn't help that whole situation. So there's a lot of really useful stuff in contrib for doing kind of debugging and inspection of serious system problems. They're not loaded by default only because they don't have to be, but if you run into a crisis, you may discover you really want some of those tools. And if you're in an environment where getting an additional package installed after everything goes into production requires an act of God or CEO, you probably don't want to be in that situation. So it's something to watch out for, make sure you've got that package available, if at all possible, before you go into production. Short list, this is maybe one third of them. There's a trio of things that actually let you look at low-level data in the database. There's PagesBack, pgstat2table, and pgspace map. These are not useful in day-to-day operation, but if you do get into situations where you're curious about things like, well, do I have index bloat or table bloat or any of these other things, it's possible, albeit not easy to do, to extract some of that information out. So having them available would be helpful. You can get some additional information about what locks are going on under the hood with this PG Roadlocks extension. There's one thing I'll talk about a little more in a second called PG Stat Statements. There's a module called Auto Explain. The concept of Auto Explain is if you've got a query and it runs long enough that it gets logged, it'll log what explain plan it executes. The main context that ends up being really useful in is if you're running your server with prepared statements, prepared statements get their parameters substituted in at runtime, and the query plans that you get for them sometimes are not exactly the same as the query plans you get if you execute them manually. So you may have a slow statement. look at the query plan and explain analyze for that statement and go, why did this run slowly? It runs fine when I run it here. And the difference is it was executed a little bit differently inside the private statement than it was outside of it. And if not auto-explained one, you'll see that happening on the explained data that's under the walls. The stuff at the bottom here is not really performance related. I just kind of list them on this floor of the more popular useful extensions for the just so you got an idea how not trivial some of these things are. There's some really handy stuff in there. PG archive cleanup got added to Postgres 9.0. It makes it easier to sort out archives of write ahead log data that you're saving on the server for making a standby system or a backup system or something like that. PG crypto is a popular module. We've got any sort of cryptography stuff. Try not to be the person who loses unencrypted copies of the database data that you've got to pirates who then try to sell it, like my good friends at Sony's PlayStation Network, who have recently leaked all of my information because of that sort of stuff. PG Crypto will give you some much better stuff for that. It's available on default, but it may not be installed by default on your server. And you may not even realize it's there unless someone's pointed out to you, hey, one of the pages in this 2000 page mess includes some functions for cryptography stuff that are quite good. DBLink is a little thing that lets you connect from one database to another database, even on different nodes. That's got all kinds of neat potential for things that are their performance problems, but that accomplish no other use for it. There's also a thing called HStore. This kind of is aimed to optimize storage and everything about the table for fairly simple key value store type information. So you can use HStore in order to make one of the tables in the Postgres database web scale. So anyway, these extensions, it's worth spending a little bit of time browsing through the contrib documentation and knowing that in Postgres 9.1, these will look much closer to the kind of first-class things that are built into the database. So I think that's going to, our suspicion is that this is going to kind of reinvigorate some of the work around these because people think, oh, wow, it really is easy to use now, so we start using it. External views. Postgres refers to the main server code as the core, and it's just that. It's only the things that must live in the database. So there's often a decision where someone will develop a tool that lives perfectly fine outside of the database, and someone will say, why don't you integrate this into this database? And the response is, because it lives perfectly fine outside of the database, why make the database more complicated than it needs to be by putting all this junk into it? That road lies to madness or workflow or another. Possibly both. So a lot of these things that are external tools, it's not that you don't need them. That's not why they're in core. They're not in core because that's not how open source projects kind of work. Open source projects, kind of the whole Unix development mindset that this stuff came out of, says let's build smaller tools and integrate them together. Let's not build one giant monolith and then make, for example, do you really want to be in a situation where the version of your monitoring system requires the same sort of vigilance and QA and everything else to upgrade as the database itself? I'd like those two things to be decoupled. I'd like to be able to upgrade the monitoring system and not have to touch the database. If this all was bundled into one giant package, you wouldn't have that option. So this is why a lot of this stuff that you really need for a successful Postgres deployment, it doesn't ship with the database, and it likely never will, because it doesn't make sense once you really embrace the open source mindset for stuff. Monitoring is, I think, the most important of those things to do. You can do some simple monitoring with operating system tools, like you've got your server set up right on a Unix system. You can use the SAR utility and get some data out. If you're on Windows, you use the Windows system monitoring tools to get performance data out of it. The trick is, you also want to monitor database tenants. I mentioned PGSet user tables a couple of times. That's one that's just really got tons of useful stuff. There's also I/O related work, PGStat/IO, PGStat index. There's all kinds of stuff. What you really want to do is you really want to capture operating system level detail, information about CPUs, information about disks, all these other things, and database information. How many rows have been updated? Are there long running transactions? You want the same tool to capture both of them, if at all possible, because where this stuff really gets powerful is if you've got a common timeline that you've been collecting data at, and you can see when these events line up. And I'll show some examples of that. Two examples of good open source tools that you can just get up and running without too much headache are Munin and Cacti. All the examples I'm going to show here are generated on Munin. Munin is really easy to get up and running. And the minute you get it pointed at your Postgres database and it's talking to it, it's just going to fill in this gigantic stack, the stack of useful Postgres graphs for you, and you're done. It's as easy as can be once you get that. So I recommend that people, if you're not doing any monitoring at all, you almost certainly can get a Munin database up and running fast enough, better than nothing. And what I'm increasingly finding happen is people throw up the, well, let's put a quick Munin database up, and then 3 years later they're going, maybe we should get a better thing than that Munin database, that Munin monitoring. The main trade-off, it's like, well, then why doesn't everybody use Munin? Why is this the standard tool? Munin is a very heavy kind of program as monitoring systems go. The thing you have to run to collect the data is a little bigger than the logic thing, and the thing on the server side that actually processes all this data and generates the graphs, it just doesn't scale to a huge number of servers. So if you have 10 servers, by all means, use Munin for it. If you have 100, you're probably going to discover it's not satisfactory. Cacti is much better at that. There are actually some specialized monitoring systems aimed at the specific job of, I have thousands of nodes I need to monitor, and I'm not really going to talk about those, but they're out there. If you're in that situation, you may discover neither of these scale as a monitor or giant networks and whatnot. But if you're just getting started, these are completely appropriate tools to consider. And Munin comes with the round of the box, and it's easier to set up than it is, so that's why I'm going to start with that. operating system monitoring, here's a sampling of commands you can use on a Unix system. If you use the top command, one thing not everybody knows, if you execute top-c on Linux, the exact thing may be a little bit different on other operating systems. I know it's different on FreeBSD. Postgres takes this thing called the command string. The command string is, what is the server doing right now? And that thing will say things like, is it running a select, or is it running an insert, or is this actually auto-backing running? So you should be able to get information out of top that shows you what the server's doing. So rather than just seeing I have 100 Postgres processes, you'll see, I have these processes that are running select, I have these processes that are running insert, and give you a much better idea what's going on. GANSTAT at a 1 second interval is kind of the standard way to figure out, what's kind of low level, what's the server doing as far as talking to disks at a big scale. The IOSTAT command, those are the flags I normally use. That's the usual thing for what's actually happening with my disk drives. Are they being used all the time on the blocks or going back and forth? And the only reason for Y5 instead of 1 is that if you run IOSTAT at 1 second intervals, you'll discover you see it bounce back and forth between all the individual disks on the server, and you give it 5 seconds worth, you tend to see better average than that. There are some more advanced tools that are floating around as well that have some use to them. HTOP is a kind of fancier, full-color top replacement. The main thing that I like HTOP for is that running a Red Hat Linux server in particular, there are some fancier things that you just can't do with Top, and you can't get IOTOP installed. So HTOP will let you track some things related to disk IO that you just can't get on the same screen that anything else. IOTOP is another neat utility. Again, it's not really available in Red Hat Linux systems running Red Hat 5, but on pretty much anything newer than that, it should be available to you. That actually shows you how much disk every individual process is running on the server. So you can see who's reading data, who's writing data, and you can discover things like, gee, how much of the workload is the backup. So IOTOP is really awesome if you've got it available. If you don't have it available, you can get some of the same data out of it on some servers. So there's one. The final thing, more of an old school kind of Unix tool, there's a thing called Watch. If you run Watch and you give it something, maybe you're printing a file out, maybe you're running a command or something like that, Watch will run that thing periodically and then update it, and it'll turn simple things into like a real-time updated sort of thing. So, you know, an example is on Linux, you can look at this file called /proc/memo. It shows you what's going on with memory in Linux right now. And if you do /watch/proc/memo, you kind of get this real-time thing that updates once a second, and you can actually see like things move around between the sections of memory and the server, and you've got that thing up and running. So if you've got something that you look at it and you go, I want to watch this and see when it changes, you can probably automate that using Watch rather than being the person who's stuck there getting hung around. So it's a handy little tool. There's a slightly different category of tools, which are what I call incident. The things I was just mentioning are for, I want to look at the server live, and I want to see what's going on. Sometimes, though, what you want to do is you want to log the low-level information about the server, so you can go back later and try to line it up when bad things happen in Postgres logs. You can run top in what it calls a batch mode, and it will write data out like that. It's kind of a pain to deal with, but you know, it's there. There's the other old school Unix utilities. There's a program called NoHop, which is good to know about. If you run NoHop in something, you can leave something running after you disconnect from the server. It kind of turns it into a mini daemon, and whatever output it produces will get sent to a NoHop log file. A lot of times, if I'm doing maintenance operations, you know, vacuums or Linux rebuilds or stuff like that, I'll create a script that does the work. And then I'll execute the script using NoHop for that. Some people prefer to use the screen command for this type of thing instead. The main advantage of NoHop is that it will be available in a lot of environments that script is not. Script is the final one in this kind of trio. If you run script, you'll end up with everything else that happens in that session from that point forward is now written to the file, including keystrokes and everything. So if you want to record something happening, and you can get that something happening to show up, and you run script and run it, you'll get a log of that whole thing that happened later. So I will sometimes, if I see, wait a minute, something bad is going on with the server, I want to investigate it, I try to remember to run script first, and then if I'm doing things like looking at logs and activity and stuff like that, and I want to go back later and review that more, I don't have to go capture it from scroll back or whatnot. I've already got a log. So these are some handy little tools. If you're using Postgres, you may discover you really want to come from your users, so you necessarily may have ever wanted to be interested. So talked about locking. In order to really figure out what's going on with locking on your server, you need to combine information that's available in pglogs with information that's available in pgstatactivity. These are both live views. Each of them has pieces of what you want to know. The wiki has a couple of different example queries that combine this data in a few ways. There's some examples in my book as well that do more complicated things. I highly recommend, again, doing this with your servers lightly loaded to get an idea of what's going on. A lot of times people are really surprised by the order in which locks get acquired. It's like, wait, that locks that? I was completely not expecting it. So it's good to get familiar with this sort of thing as early as you can, because if you don't know what it looks like in an easy case, it's difficult to distinguish, wait, is this screwed up, or does it always acquire locks like this? So trying to sort that sort of data out is hard to do once the server is really busy. It's a lot better if you can run some tests and simulate things on a smaller system without that many things, and become familiar and get your own little toolkit that you're comfortable with that works the way you want for analyzing this data. Put that together, because potentially you're not going to get anything that comes with Postgres. You may very well run into these possibilities or something else. Database monitoring. I mentioned these two already. I mentioned TOPC. There's also another utility called PG_top floating around. PG_top is another one of these things that you can add in. It actually shows the full text of the query along with the information about CPUs, using and stuff like that. If you're looking for something that's more like an interactive database dashboard kind of thing, what's the server actually doing at the moment, it's probably the closest thing to that you can just compile and run it and go with from there. So these things are all kind of handy, but for me, a real-time views are great, but what I really spend a lot more time doing is capturing stuff in a way that I can do something like long-term. An additional component to this is alerting. So there's monitoring, in my mind, is alerting plus real-time data plus trending, which is historical stuff. Alerting, I'll just mention briefly here, because the trending stuff's a little bit. If your server runs out of disk space, it's going to crash, and it's not going to be pretty to recover from. You really want to watch for that. The most common way that I see servers in Postgres run out of disk space is it's a pretty good performance practice to put the write-ahead logs for the server on another drive. That drive tends to be smaller than the rest of them. If you're using Postgres's replication to make a copy of your database, and it's possible that write-ahead log space will fill if something happens with the backup server. And so you could actually have the primary server say, under no circumstances am I going to proceed until I've sent this data, until I've archived it, the archive and the backup server. You can set that up in a way that when the backup server, what Postgres calls the standby, runs out of space, the main server runs out of space eventually too, and then the main server goes down because of a problem with standby. So you really need to check this stuff on the standby servers as well as the backup, as well as the main one and the backup servers that you're doing. It's very easy for write-ahead log stuff to get out of control and crash because it's using a ton of disk space for things. You may be surprised at how big the logs are relative to your database. There's a program called Nagios, sort of the standard open source utility for this stuff floating around that monitors things. It's not great, but it works, and it's integrated with pagers and all sorts of other stuff. There's a utility called Check Postgres that's the standard one to integrate in with Nagios. It includes lots of checks, even for it even makes a guess at complicated things like table load. It tries to estimate that. It's not super accurate or great, but it at least gives you a trend line to follow over time if you look at it. You can use Check Postgres in other alerting systems, and what I do recommend to people is even if you're not using Nagios, even if you're not using Check Postgres, look at Check Postgres anyway, because the information that Check Postgres is looking at and that it saves is information that's been proven to be useful data to look at to keep your Postgres instance running. So sometimes you can look at it and go, well, I can't use this tool, but that's a neat idea for monitoring. Let me build something that monitors that same thing and monitors it. And a lot of the queries that it runs are actually just non-trivial SQL. And so you'll get the source code to it and come up with something else. So definitely take a look at that if you haven't already. Even if you know you're never going to use it, use it for mining for ideas. Trends. Trending is the last component of monitoring. Trends matter a lot. This is an honest-to-God customer database. We reinstalled their server in the end of January because they've been running into performance problems. And they said to me the other day, hey, how come our server is not responding to queries in all circumstances in under a second anymore? And I told them, well, that's because your database has doubled in the last 3 months. This is what the beginning of infamous exponential growth looks like on an app. You start seeing stuff like this, it doesn't matter how much you do or how much you do. If you're growing like this, you're gonna suffer some problems. And stuff like this is why you want to get these graphs and get them all lined up in your mind. If I didn't have this historical context, when I got asked the question, why are things so much slower than they were when they migrated to the server in the end of January, I may not have had a good answer to it. Now it's, oh, well, look, there you go. The database is twice as big. It's really hard to get as much data as you used to get more. And it's got to process more rows for that answer's query. So, there's usually a big discontinuity for people. When the server no longer fits in RAM, it gets a lot harder to tune in than when everything fit in RAM. Sloppy things. So this server has 64 gigabytes of RAM in it. As you can see, you can almost project out exactly when this thing is going to start running into more serious performance problems. And being able to see the size crossed RAM and oh look, these other performance problems popped up. Lets you have a good idea what's going on. And a lot of performance tuning is just assigning cause and effect and getting the right relationships. And sometimes the cause is just there's more data to go through, it's going to take longer to do it. So here's load average. Load average is a measure of how many processes are running at any particular time on the database. The load average will normally be less than the number of cores that you've got in the server if things are happy. Once it starts climbing above that number, you start getting information between cores, things kind of fall apart. So this is an operating system number that you can get by pulling utilities, but dragging it over time. It's kind of like a gross figure for what's going on with CPUs. This is a low-level detail from Munin. Munin actually displays this information in a somewhat unique format that I found really like. So the concept here is there's 8 processors on the server, 8 cores, and this total goes to 800%, because essentially if every processor was 100% utilized, that would be 800% total. And it breaks that down by what those things are doing. So the main categories here are all of this yellowish stuff that's in here, that's idles. This is when the server is doing that. This blue stuff here, this is when it's actually running stuff in user land, which is typically the database queries are running. This green stuff you can just barely make out at the bottom, that's the operating system doing things. If you've got some sort of slowdowns because the operating system is doing wacky things with sockets or other networking stuff or whatnot, one of the ways you can tell that is that system number starts becoming disproportionate and that will be totally relative to the rest of it. And then this purplish bit at the top, that's IO wait. That's how often one of the processes on the server was waiting for disk activity to happen. So this example right here, we can see two distinct type of workloads, or three distinct, really. We've got most of the time where the server's doing nothing. Then we've got this here, which this is, if you notice, this is exactly at 100%. This was running something that was running one giant query that kept the CPU busy all of the time, but did no disk activity. That's what it'll look like. So that's running like that. It's not touching the disks. It's not using all that much resources, but one of the queries is stopped just using the entire disk. This is a little bit different than this time period here. Here we can see that there's a CPU that's trying to run at 100% of the time, but it's not really working because there's a good chunk of time where it's waiting for I.O. during that whole section instead. So this was actually a section of time where I was loading data in a way that there were two processes involved in the whole thing. And then so at any particular time, you know, one of them was actually doing the work, one of them was doing, you know, importing related stuff, and then, well, why do these numbers add up? They're more than 100%. The third thing that was involved in this whole mess was Postgres's background writer, which was also busy doing waiting for a lot of the I/O and doing other stuff. So if you display this information with other monitoring tools like CACD and whatnot, the graph isn't quite as slick as this one, but the same basic data is there. You really need to sort out CPU time versus system time versus I/O wait time, and then I/O times, whatever's left over on the whole thing. Keep track of that stuff. It's important. And then even on Windows, the same set of counters are there. They're named slightly differently. I even put a little court translation table in my book to make it easier to figure out what they're called. But you know, the way that you monitor a server and CPU resources versus anything else are in common to the database and the operating system. This is disk utilization percentage. The idea is that Linux gives a number between 0 and 100 for what percent of the time approximately it was waiting for the disk at any particular moment. So what you want to watch for here, and this is the same section of time we were just looking at, so this is where I start talking about lining things up. You notice 11, 12, 14, 15, these are days of the week. And so we've got this ugly section here. There's a lot of waiting for I/O. We now drill down into what exactly was going on. Now we can see exactly what was going on. For whatever reason, this green bar here, this represents SDA, so that's the first of the six disks that have to be in the system. So whatever was going on with the server, it was doing a little bit of I/O to the other disks, but the process was hitting some sort of bottleneck where that SDA disk was busy 100% of the time. When you see a particular disk is sitting at 100% utilization and I/O wait is high and everything else, that's probably where your bottleneck is whatever's going on with that disk. In this case, the particular bottleneck happened because SDA happened to be where the data files I was loading was at. The things down here, you know, CD, EMF, those are actually the database disks itself. And so the bottleneck was basically it couldn't. The loading process I was going through couldn't read. It was reading inefficiently. It was bad script. And it was actually using the whole disk up for what it was doing and not actually keeping the database busy at all. So if I wouldn't have had this kind of per disk breakdown, I might have thought the database was the bottleneck, but it wasn't. It was totally sitting over on the operating system disk, which happened to be where I put the data files on. This is why breaking this stuff out per disk and converting it to percentage is useful. This is the same data you get out of, I mentioned the iostat-mx before is a good command. That also spits you out the Linux disk percentage. Connections, this we talked about a bit already too. Connections in Postgres, they can be active, which means they're running a query right now. The active ones are these green ones down at the bottom. The orangish ones that are the majority of those are idle connections. So someone is connected to the database, but at that particular moment in time, they're not actually running a query. The connection's open, and the server's sort of waiting for them to request the next chunk of data. This information is extracted from pgstat activity. This is essentially pgstat activity grouped by whatever the transaction state of the thing is based upon the command it shows. It just so happens that in Postgres, something that's active but idle has the text greater than brackets idle in it. And so if you specifically look with saying idle and transaction and whatnot, you can derive this data. So this is a good example of what I was talking about, where using view, and I really like the way that this was displayed in Union, and I think it's a good way to look at it, this kind of stack chart thing. And I had a customer that we were trying to figure out how to set work memo on the server. We needed to know how many active connections were there, as opposed to ones that were just sitting idle. And this is how we wanted to extract that data. Well, the problem is they weren't running Union. Well, we went and looked at the source code of Union, found this query that actually extracts this data from PGStat activity, and then figured out how to get the same data to show up in Happy instead. So there's no reason you could pull this data out as a regular old query. It's just some relatively slick SQL that someone put together that summarizes the data in a useful way, and you don't have to be using this monitoring system to get it. If you're using another one, you can take this concept and do your own implementation of it by monitoring the PGStat activity. So when we were talking about things like work memo before, the question were, well, do I size it based on the total connections or the active connections? This is a way you can figure out how many are the actual active connections, fine tune that a little bit better. While this system has over 300 people connected to it at any point, this is pretty obviously not ever running 200 concurrent connections at once, so you might be able to set work memo a little bit higher on this than you would have just by assuming every connection. This gives you an idea of the kind of data you can get out of the shared buffer statistics. This is showing what everybody's reading out of shared buffers and how often it's hit. Those graphs are often the same, suggesting this data is mostly cached. The sort of stuff you want to look for on this are, like, this isn't so strange. This big green bar says, this is from the, that is one of the benefits to look for. That's saying that a lot of data actually had to get read from the operating system during that particular chunk of time. So, you know, that represented something that was doing a bad operation in the database. So when I see something like that, I go, wait a minute, why was there this big spike? What did it do that was reading so much more data? Go back into query logs and figure it out. If you've got this information on a nice time scale, you've got it. These are the sort of things that sometimes you need to know. This is the summary across the entire database of the statistics. And what you can use this sort of information for is figuring out what kind of workload you've got. So these things here are all sequential scans. These things, and that's a count of the number of rows. These things down here are index lookups, and the stuff that you're not seeing on here would show you inserts and updates and reads and stuff like that. So what this is telling us is the workload on this server is almost all reads. There's very little insert read update traffic on this thing, and the majority of the reads that are happening as part of sequential scans we use. So this is actually not a problem for this database. This is the case because a good chunk of the data that's the most active in the database are tiny tables that always get sequentially scanned just because they're tiny tables, you know, with information you know, that some people call factor dimension tables, the kind of things you join everything with in order to encode them. So this is not a problem, but when stuff like this pops up, it suggests, okay, let me go figure out at the per table level who's actually doing all of these reads and figure out, does all this sequential access, is that sensible or is it just really dumb at this point?
Is it possible to see a graph of combining this in the total one so you can see not just the reads but the actual physical reads that occur on a distributed?
All this, if you've got a monitoring system, you're not necessarily going to get them all the same graph, but I mean, if you've got them on the same scale, which these two are, you can look at the two right next to one another and try to look for patterns. So I mean, these are graphs of the exact same time period, so you are essentially getting that just by looking at the two graphs. A lot of times the graphs are not actually combined only because the scales are slightly different. Like, this is measured in buffers per second, goes back to, see, like, if you look at this thing, if I were to overlay on top of the disk I/O statistics, you'd probably see the spike in disk I/O as well. You know, these are the sort of, this is why you need to monitor all these letters, and then when events happen, go back and figure out later, okay, what just happened. Long queries. It's possible to go into BGSAT activity and ask for what Postgres calls the age of the timestamp. And you can also just subtract what the current time system timestamp is from the transaction begin or the query begin timestamps. If you do those, you can compute out of all the things that are active right now, what's the oldest running transaction? And then what's the oldest running query? And both of those numbers are interesting and very interesting to graph over time. So this one is not all that exciting, but it does let us know that there's something that runs on the server quite regularly that's causing this little spike where even though the queries are short, something is holding transactions open for 5 or 10 seconds quite often. So that suggests, that's a little strange. Why is it holding the transaction open, but not actually, that's not where the query is happening? It's a little interesting. And then this thing here, this is the stuff you really want to watch out for. If, you know, in the event of an actual emergency, this seconds would become hours, and this number would be so big that it would dwarf all the rest of the data on it, and that's when you go, oh crap, what has been running in a single transaction for hours, because those are the exact situations where vacuum is going to stop while it's happening. So here's a graph you can do that will show you the visually how long an average transaction is and a typical one is, so that when a longer one shows up, it really becomes visible. This same server, I grabbed this data on, and then later they had a query that stayed open for 3 days, and vacuum never got cleaned up, and then they had a disk space. It was a whole cascade of failures, and you could trace them all back to, at the beginning, this transaction just started having its time go up and up because it had something that was running for a long time. It should not have been keeping an open transaction. So that's kind of the quick tour of Munin. This is just a subset of the database stuff that's in Munin. And every one of these things I just showed you, out of the box, you install Munin, you want it in a Postgres database, you get all those graphs. And a lot more. So that's why I like it, and I find it inspirational. Query log. Postgres doesn't really have any good integrated stuff for monitoring queries in the database with it. The main mechanism for getting some of it is there's a parameter called log event duration statement. The idea is you set that to how long a query has to run before it's interesting that it ran that way. So fine-tuning that, as I commented before on the auto vacuum one, you have to be careful to make it long enough that it's only showing you interesting data, but not so short that the logs has to fill it with general. Auto-explain, I also already mentioned, if you got this thing on, auto-explain kicks in when this threshold is exceeded. That's when you can log all this stuff together. There are basically two ways you can do this. You can write all the data to the log, to the log file, and then you go analyze it later. Or you can use something that's built in starting in Postgres 8.4 called PGStat statements. And PGStat statements, you give it a block of memory and you go here, you can please record statistics about whatever you can fit into this block of memory I've given you. And then it does a best effort way to try to keep the most popular things that happen in that block of memory. PGStat statements tends to not be a complete replacement for saving the data in the query logs because it's lossy. Some of the data gets thrown away. And so I find people end up doing a little bit of both of these to this point. You might get a real-time view of what's going on with the server with PGStat statements, but for long-term analysis and kind of figuring out, okay, what did the server do all day, popular albums are working called Peachy Gleam. What Peachy Gleam does is produce neat bits of output like this. This is the most key bit to pay attention to. This is summing up all of the queries that ran on the server that look like this, and it does some ways to reduce them to get the approximately 4 seconds. So what this is saying is, this first query here, these all executed the same number of times. This is one of PG Bash, and the score is example from PG Bash. What this is saying is, even though all of these execute the same number of times each day, it ran just over 43,000 times, the key bit is, on average, this one took almost 300 seconds to run. And this one, the total time on that is way huge. So the way they end up using data like this is, if you got this output, one thing that people love to do is speculate on why performance problems. If you describe a performance problem for a group of people, they'll spend all day talking about, wow, I wonder what's causing that. I wonder if it's this. I wonder if it's this. What people who do this for a living do is assume that whatever your guess is wrong, and that you're not going to get it wrong, right, and do profiling instead. It's actually a measure of time. And sometimes you get it right, and sometimes you go, huh, I didn't expect that at all. So the trick is, when you get data like this, this focuses you on the things that are really slow on the server. So you might have looked at this, and you might have thought, this update on the branches table here, that's got a lot of contention around locks. So maybe this thing is slow because the contention around the locks are okay. That would be a completely reasonable theory that you might come up with for why this thing is slow if you were just looking at the transactions, but you'd be completely wrong. It's actually this update here is the thing where almost all the time is going on this whole thing. So when you get logs like this, the trick is whatever are at the top and whatever the things that are taking the bulk of the runtime up, that's where you gotta spend your time optimizing. Because you can, in this workload, you can optimize numbers 2 through 4 all day, and it's gonna have almost no impact on the actual performance. However, if you don't take care of the thing that's at number one here head on, you're never going to make this sort of faster via query tuning on this particular workload. So for non-trivial stuff, getting this log file out every day and kind of seeing what the trends look like over the time is one of those things. It's not built into Postgres, but you really want to start doing it before the server gets slow, because you know what a good workload looks like before it goes bad, and also it gives you an idea what baseline behavior you should be checking for. And it's just really informative as far as figuring out how the server is responsive. You may be surprised at exactly what it's really doing. Logging. This is my standard logging I throw on every server just to get a basic configuration. The log line prefix gets added to every log in the log file. You may have noticed at some point the default one logs almost no useful information other than the statement itself. There's no timestamp, there's no nothing. This one is actually the example that's given in the PGPN documentation. This is the format PGPN expects the data to be in. If you want to be able to do things like, hey, PGPN, can you please break down the query times by user and what database you're connected to? If you logged in this format, you can do that. If you didn't, it's not going to be able to do that. And so if you've got historical log data, you may not be able to analyze it the way you'd like. And then later, a lot of times it's easier to just put it in at the beginning. The only thing you're paying is the additional overhead of writing these logs now. Unless your queries are really trivial, it's probably driven more by the size of the queries that show up than it is by this little everything. Log min duration statement, I recommend setting it to something. This sets it to 1 second, and you can tweak that until it stops annoying you to no end. But what I don't recommend doing is just setting it to some giant value and then just ignoring it like the feature doesn't exist at all. You want to set it to something that it doesn't bother you, but it's still a limit. It's just above where your workload is, because is generating no allowed output now doesn't mean that you should go without protection of when things start slowing down. They start showing up here before they start showing up by angry phone calls and mobs with pitchforks and torches. Temp files are what happens when something doesn't fit with WorkMem. So something, if it does the comparison with WorkMem, it goes, I can't do this in memory, it writes it to a temp file instead. If you log those, you can use that as feedback for, did I set WorkMem correctly? If you see a lot of stuff showing up there, that suggests, say, wait a minute, let me find out what those queries are doing. Those are the queries that we can use in our WorkMem, because they're writing all these temporary files out. Checkpoints, I'm going to do a whole talk just about checkpoints in excruciating detail. I like to turn the checkpoint logging on right from the beginning because when checkpoint problems do pop, they're kind of odd and mysterious, and if you haven't been logging them from day one, you may not recognize what really mysterious things compared to your own. Log connections is probably the first of these I turn off. Once the server gets working normally, you probably don't want to log each of the connections. But it can be good for initial troubleshooting and trying to figure out, kind of, okay, where did this connect and you know, when did this connect and you know, things like that. Log lock points is another not necessarily obvious one. You probably want to turn on and set. There's a related parameter called the deadlock timeout that controls how chatty it is. That's set to 1 second by default, so maybe that. The idea here is every time Postgres goes to acquire a lock and it has to wait longer than that deadlock timeout number, over to a second, it's going to log that. So if your application, essentially your application that's waiting for something in the database, it can be waiting for a query to execute, it can be waiting to acquire a lock, it can be waiting for the disk drives. Distinguishing between those things, one of those things is an important thing to do. This lets you single out how long was it waiting for the lock as the component for this whole thing. And there's no other really good way to collect that data. So turning that on by default and getting used to that data and some idea of it is definitely a good idea. And then the auto vacuum that I already mentioned as well. So this is like what a basic, I want to do what I call defensive logging. Let's log the things that are likely to go bad later, before they go bad, from day one, then just get used to what those log files look like.
Is there a particular reason that you prefer this type of format over than doing the CSV log? Because I know pgfuina is compatible with both.
Right.
Or is it just an old habit?
It's more the case that a lot of people don't like dealing with the CSV logs. I'm the wrong person to ask to defend why you shouldn't use the CSV logs as one of the co-authors of the CSV feature. I kind of think it's really cool, but some people just don't like the chattiness of the logs that comes out of those logs.
Okay.
This looks more like a traditional log file that comes out of everything else on your server. The CSV logs, this alternate way you can write them out, is really great, and it's better for analysis than the other ways you can do it, but it's not going to look like the rest of the log files in your system, that kind of freaks people out. So I'll absolutely use CSV logging for a server that I'm managing, but I don't tend to do it by people for other people unless I have a long talk with them about what logging format is appropriate for. So there's the sort of stuff you, if you're not logging it, probably should be. Connection pooling, one of the little story I'd like to. The quick version here is that connections in Postgres are expensive, and they're likely to remain expensive. The problem of optimizing a large number of connections is not that interesting to resolve for two reasons. The kind of thresholds here is somewhere around 500 active connections, whether or not the connections do anything. Like if they're connected, they're taking up some internal resources and shared memory that the server has to deal with. Somewhere around 500 or so at once, that tends to break down on most systems. If you're on a Windows server, it will mysteriously die with bizarre memory allocations at 125-ish, which is real fun. people go, well, that's ridiculous. I have thousands of users connecting to this database. You know, why is this limit here at this number? What's going on? The thing to realize, though, the two things. One, this doesn't have to be a hard limit. There's external pieces of software called connection poolers that will funnel larger numbers of users into a smaller number of connections to the database. The two that are most popular are called Peachy Bouncer and Peachy Pool 2. The main distinction between them is much like the new and happy ones. Peachy Bouncer is a little lighter weight, a little more efficient. Peachy Pool 2 is heavier, but has some more features that you may find useful to it. So, you know, which is appropriate, and it depends on what you're doing with them. The thing to realize is that modern processors, every time one process that's doing something with memory gets swapped for another process that's doing something with memory, this is very disruptive to the cache of the CPU. And if you have more than some number of those happening at the same time, you get to where the CPU doesn't get any real work done anymore. It just pages in the data. And remember, in a database, you're always moving around these 8K blocks of data that represent the stuff that you're doing. By the time you paged in, okay, I need this set of instructions for the CPU, I need this 8K of data to do something for this table, and I need this 8K of data for this other thing. By the time you swapped all that onto the CPU, you want to actually do some real work before you switch to another process that may have to swap all that stuff back out of cache. So the idea is, if you've got a large number of connections, the last thing you want to do from a performance perspective in any database, it's not specific to Postgres, is let them run at all at the same time. They'll just fight over CPU contention and resources. They don't really get all that much useful done. If your goal is high performance at a large number of connections, it's unexpected, but the way to do that is to force the database to only handle a small number of connections. Let them queue up instead. Let them wait in some other process. Let the database finish each query as efficiently as it can, and then boot that thing out of memory all out altogether and move on to the next one, so that it's not having all this cache disruption and all this other stuff. It's just really problematic on new CPUs and things. So optimal connections performance-wise on a lot of systems ends up being 2 to 3 times the number of cores, that's it. So I've got people who are running 48-core servers and they're going, seriously, I'm supposed to limit this to 150 connections? And they have that attitude until they actually benchmark it and go, oh wow, huh, that does work, doesn't it? So it's something to be aware of if you've got a large number. The idle ones are not as bad. Idle connections in Postgres do not have this cache contention and the CPU issue. However, they do take up some resources. They cause extremely large numbers, even of idle connections, to slow things down a little bit. It all has to do, again, with the ugliness of how transaction IDs are kept track of, or visibility information. Every transaction essentially has to be aware of the visibility information of every other transaction or all sorts of computations. So that runtime. Resource limits. I've already talked about WorkMem. There are other things that can use memory in the server that are not really limited very well. So it's actually not impossible to have a single query go crazy as far as using too much memory. So it is a problem with Postgres. There's not really a good answer for it other than monitor your Postgres server and just stop trying to catch it in advance. It's very difficult to balance even WorkMem across the whole server. Because if you set it too aggressively, you can run out of memory and all server crashes, and that's no good. And it's never a limit. It's always a guideline for decision. So just because you set WorkMem to 100 megabytes doesn't mean you're only going to use 100 megabytes. You could use a gigabyte if you happen to have 10 sorting or hashing operations going on at once. There's also no general resource limit. Postgres. You can't say, this guy is a lower priority user, don't let him run a big event somewhere. It's not there yet. The only, there's two things you can do. One is there is a thing called statement timeout that I do recommend you consider turning on in your default configuration and setting it to some value that is unlikely to ever bother anybody. The idea here is once something has run for longer than statement timeout, it gets killed. So typical is kind of settings for statement timeout a day. You set it to a day, if a user submits some ridiculous query that's going to run for a week, you know, it'll at least kill them after a day rather than just running that crazy thing for a whole week or something like that. So a common kind of thing that I see people do is set statement timeout to 8 hours a day, something like that, and then the occasional query that really does take more than 8 hours of the day, set statement timeout back to the default before you run it. This is also in the category that people go, wait, that does that? Which is statements can override their own timeout. So just because you've taken a user and you've given them a statement timeout, if the user's smart enough, he can go set his own statement timeout, which is bigger than that, and turn it off altogether before he runs his query. So this is not a defense against intentional abuse. It's really hard to limit intentional abuse of Postgres still. It's more aimed at let's try to keep people from accidentally destroying the server. There's also some utilities called NICE and IONICE that are operating system level things on most Unix systems that give you the ability to do something about resources on one particular user. You can at least hint at it. There's a page on the wiki that talks about the current state of the art for plain tricks on that. Replication, I'll just pass over briefly. There's a lot of replication stuff for the conference. The built-in replication in Postgres is not replicating statements. It's not actually copying the text from the statement over. It's actually copying the blocks that are changed in the database. That's what gets replicated with the replication stuff that's built in as a Postgres. Because of that, you can't make it fine-grained even if you wanted to. It's going to copy the entire database cluster, which is all the databases, all the system catalogs of it, and all gets copied over, and that's it. You can't make it any more fine-grained than that. This does let you do some scaling operations where you can send a read-only query to one of the copies of the data that's in there. That's what Postgres not now. The surprise there to be aware of is that if you do that, it is possible for queries running against the standby system to get canceled under some circumstances. Query cancellation is possible in a lot of strange conditions that people don't expect in the database. There are things like serialization failures and some other weird stuff. But it's rare that they happen to people, so application developers tend not to target them specifically. If you're using reads sent to a standby system, it moves from very unlikely to happen to significantly more likely to happen. So it's something that you want to try to prevent. There are some better features to help prevent query cancellation with some tunables.
You mentioned NICE. Do we not have to worry about priority inversion?
You always have to worry about priority. The article on the wiki. So this is just a summary of low-level issues. This is, in fact, the last slide, so I'm almost done here. Log checkpoints, I do recommend turning that on to look for spikes there. It's a complicated process, but it's good to have the better the data earlier. Lock weights, I mentioned log lock weights to try to find those. Foreign keys and constraints sometimes surprise people with how much overhead they take in Postgres. They can be a lot more expensive than you might imagine them to be. And if you do deferred constraints on things such that they only hit your commit time, that actually makes a giant queue of those things in memory, and that amount of memory can become problematic if you say, well, I'm going to solve my foreign key and constraint problem. Ball, that's all well and good until you go commit the transaction and then they all have to be dealt with once in the previous part. So don't assume that constraints are not user-free. There's actually some unfortunate and well-recognized problems where they are definitely slower than anyone would like to be in Postgres. Over-indexing is another common performance. performance mistake people make. Indexes are expensive, they're expensive to create, they're expensive to maintain, and there are a lot of situations that people expect them to get used that they don't. When you add an index to something, don't index any more columns than absolutely necessary, and make sure to monitor the statistics on the indexes to make sure things were used. Because last month I went to a database and dropped 200 gigabytes worth of unused indexes. It was just using this space and causing problems, and they were none of them had been used the entire time the server had been up. So, I'm not going to go into a full query thing, especially as I'm running out of time. But Postgres can combine indexes. So if you have a query and it's running and it's using column A and column B, Postgres can take an index on A and an index on B, combine those two indexes, and use them together. Using what's called a bitmap index scan, it doesn't need to have an index on A and B to be able to do that. So a lot of times people make these giant multi-column indexes, and what they'd be better off doing is just putting in single columns instead of letting them get combined in the cases where it's actually helpful. Another random little thing, all of these things I've been talking about for increasing memory, if you're on Linux in particular, makes it more likely you will run into this thing called the Linux out memory killer. In Postgres, loves to be killed by the out of memory killer. due to technical limitations, again, revolving around the kernel's general hostility towards people that allocate lots of shared memory. There's some behavior there, and there's recommendations in the manual and lots of other places. If you're running on Linux and you're familiar with the out of memory killer, you should go take a look at it because it is going to really let you know it or not. The final low level thing also is more a topic of my other talk at this conference. If you want things to be able to commit quicker on Postgres, due to the nature of just how disks work, you really need a piece of hardware called a battery back write cache to make that work. And one of the performance problems that's also a problem with Postgres is that whether or not your disk hardware is set up correctly to cache information can end up affecting the reliability of the database. If you've got the system that's set up to cache incorrectly and there's a crash in the database, you can discover that the database doesn't come back up like you expect it to, because disks are not honest with the database about what they're doing. Calls the database to lose its mind after a database crash. So it's another topic we're looking into. If you're not familiar with what a volatile active cache is, there's a page on the wiki now called Reliable Writes. Those are the things that are popular. Just going to go to questions. I want to let people run, so just do other things. I've already showed you the books. My book is just filled with hundreds of pages like this ridiculous level of detail here, but even more so. I like to think they've kind of advanced some of the Postgres stuff and make it easier to move past the easy questions right onto the very hard ones and stuff, which is good. I also do training classes beginning in this fall. The idea is that this part of why I do this sort of thing is that it's a big ad for multi-day long training stuff, and I'll do those on site of your company, and we're starting to announce all the things here in the last week this year. And the concept with our training classes is that everyone in the second quadrant across the world who's giving a training class does real-world DBA stuff, and it's not just going to be the end of that fun little anecdotes like the sort of things. So that's the end. We'll open up questions on here.